called Tim and out of those people, not one of them knew who this person was. So I'm not saying that would be with you. You have such qualifications and I can't imagine anyone that would say something good about you. And it's to your credit that you have these great judges here that are here. You mentioned something that someone that was in prison 10 years, that would be the sentence.
An extra 10 years.
Yeah. Well, we just saw this week a man, 16 years old, who was incarcerated wrongly and accused of killing a car driver. And after 38 years of being in prison, they find out he's innocent. I absolutely cried when I saw him on TV. I thought he's a man, 54 years old, coming out with his mother dying, and then his mother left to see him. And he said, I thought I would die in prison. And I thought, and I might be wrong. I do a lot of investigating. I'm always full time here. And I might be wrong, and you can correct me, but I've heard there's about 10% of people in prison that are wrongly convicted. Now, everybody says they're innocent. I know that. This one who it was. Do you think that's correct?
I don't have a view on any percentage, but obviously we now have DNA that we didn't have, before 1991. So there's those cases, and all I did see the news article on the case you mentioned, it was stunning. Also, we have in Maine and we have much more strict rules on allowing identification in court. Now you cannot have the victim get up and point out the defendant. He's the guy unless that victim has already made an untainted, fair, out of court eyewitness identification. So I've read many, many times that the largest source of wrongful conviction is faulty eyewitness identification. So the rules, and just recently since I've come on speaker, have been tightened up significantly. And I know one judge who said since he has given the new eyewitness identification instruction, which basically tells the jurors, mine is not like a video recorder. For example, with this gun pointing in your face, you're going to focus on the gun, not so much the face. He says, since I had given the new eyewitness identification instruction, which is so strict, he has not had one guilty verdict. So he's concerned it's gone too far. So with the tightening up of eyewitness identification mistakes, and obviously now DNA, there's an expectation that those types of miscarriage of justice will not
occur. But I do want to say that I do credit if you remember the Cahill disposition, do you have something with the Cahill disposition?
That's not me.
Okay, all right. That was more than you do, but it was on the books about how much time you have to give someone with repeat time drivers. That's okay. Tell me about the probation department and debt scandal. You were on the task force. How do you involve in that?
On probation?
Well, there's this probation department and you were on a task force.
What information does Mr. Chapman was here this morning?
Oh my God. Are they doing brain treatment? All right, okay. Let's see. Juvenile, they're talking about putting the age up to 21 years old. What do you think about that?
Well, I did not practice in juvenile court. One of my former law partners, Judge Swartz, was on juvenile court. I had conversations about in general. I'm not aware about the proposal to go to 21.
Well, it's been proposed, so we should do changing from 18 to 21.
I'd be very interested in reading the studies on that, why that's a good idea, why that's a bad idea. It's not an issue of money.
Well, I have my opinion for what it's worth. I just was wondering what you asked, but it just seems to me that there's some egregious crimes by people. We saw that with the high school boy who really raped and murdered his teacher. But my investigation, the juvenile court couldn't take on more children, which is the other half of that, so I don't know. I'm going to ask you something that actually was a case before the appeals court. And this is real. This is real. And then when I met with you and I talked with you again, I didn't tip you off on this, so I want everybody to know that. And there was a case where a woman was walking these two dogs. There were two German shepherds. One was off leash and one wasn't. And so the German shepherd that was loose ran on a lawn where a woman was there on her front lawn with her little dog. And the German shepherd took the dog back. Now the dog lived. Surgery cost $4,000. So she sued the man who had the dog that hit her. So when it went to court, the judge ruled the dog was property and then she could only get $400.
My memory is that may be by statute.
This went to the appeals court now.
Right.
Okay, you're a judge on the appeals court. That came before you.
Well, obviously, I'm going to read the briefs and it was a little weird and it was my colleagues. But my memory is that that for a long time, by statute, the dog, that you can't recover for damage to a dog because it's property. And there's either a low limit or a statutory cap on that, which seems a little harsh because I love dogs too.
My wife,
I have not received permission. My 11-year-old child wanted a dog, and mom is not agreed to the dog yet.
I've got to tell you, I'm disappointed. The appeals court gave her $4,000,
really?
And the dog wasn't property.
Okay.
And I just want to say, this is not the most exciting place for an 11-year-old in this whole thing. But it is an interesting case.
Well, as a dog lover, I'm not disappointed. I'll say that, but no, that one got by me.
We talked about mandatory sentencing. I testified last month in the State House for criminal reform that minimum mandatory sentencing is wrong, that the size was not the law. How do you see it in you as a judge that legislation interferes with legislation? Can you point out?
Yeah, I can't do any better than that example I gave about the fellow who's convicted on a drug charge, but he has a bullet in his pocket, so boom, an extra 10 years. I don't think anyone enjoys having their discretion limited, but you know, the legislature sets the penalty. And the Lawful Society case, I came for the SJC, where my colleague declined to apply the mandatory minimum and gave her reasons. And the SJC reversed her and said, no, it's a mandatory minimum, but you may recall Chief Justice Gans established a study of mine that is working hard and trying to examine both sides of the issue, and then we'll issue a report to the court. And I think the hope is, for those who are against mandatory minimum, is that report, that study report, will have some impact on the legislature. We know where the DA stands. But I'd be very interested to see what that study comes up with as a report and see what the recommendations are, what the findings are, and see whether or not it does or does not have an impact on what.
Well, I think it does. I think there's a strong support that it would be overturned. It was a political thing, and it was a legislation that had a flag and it sounds good to your constituents, and it really wasn't. And I know. My experience here, we had someone that was looking for was looking to be was it not probation for he wanted to be he had been sentenced to 5 years, now it changed to 2 years, and he had been in ruined his whole life as far as coming to. First of all, he was 17 years old.
Oh,
and he was on his way to school. And 22-year-old was trying to stop him. And says, "Can you be available in 5 bags of marijuana?" He was in his closet. And he, innocent, was a good kid, just makes a fatal mistake. And he sold one bag. And then he went to another student and got a student reported him. And the principal found bags of marijuana in the lock. And at that time, they spent people in Dave's proms, football, maybe could have scholarship. So when he came up, he was lucky he could probably go out in private school with the children, very involved in the community, volunteered, stability, and all of that. And now he's coming for us, 57 years old. After a lot of health problems, lost a leg, he's had cancer, all of this. And here he is, got a job, 57. Where's he going to go? I mean, we approved it, but where's he going to go in 57? And that's the type of mandatory sentencing that's wrong. Because he just made such a foolish mistake that I know, I just feel like that judge that he heard before, he or she would have done something different. Don't you think?
Thank you. We always look for alternatives to incarceration that are appropriate in a particular case. So that's a hard case that I think if anybody's concerned, I'd be interested to see what the study group says about a case like that.
I don't think we did any better. I don't know if we have done a job after that time out of 57, never mind, you know, having that baggage. You know what I like? I like that you're 32 years in private practice. I really like that. Any case, it doesn't matter. But, you know, to me, and we've had good people at Attorney General, but they give it, now this is my opinion, they give them the case, and the police give them their report, so they're halfway there, but you choose who you're going to represent, and I think that's the difference. And the other thing is, I think you have more respect for, not, maybe that's not the word, but more understanding of when an attorney comes in with this client, that the client's paying. You're going to arrange that you're not going to wait for hours. And, you know, I just think it's just, and you have to be responsible for shoveling the walk and paying the rent and all that. I just think it gives you a little more, you know, experience. Do you think that's true? Do you hear anything?
Well, I think on the civil side, as you pointed out, the public sector doesn't bring the case. The client has to persuade someone in the private sector that they have a worthy case. And if you take a plaintiff's case and you lose the case, you're not going to get paid. And so these are life-shattering experiences where children are killed in accidents and wrongful death cases. They're really just as important as criminal cases. We always tell that to the jury when I analyze the case. This is a civil case. The police aren't involved. It's just as important as a criminal case. But unless that client can persuade a lawyer to take that case, they're not going to get justice. And so it's a big responsibility.
Following up on that, you had a case where a college age student was killed and you represented the parents.
Yeah.
And that didn't turn out well.
No, it didn't. We lost the jack and I tried to get the Henner case. And we thought that the defendant ran a stop sign and struck and killed this kid. And the jury just didn't buy it. And for a short time, I kind of lost faith in the jury system. I just couldn't understand it. Turn that beautiful mom and dad away, but they did. And there were no legal errors. The jury just didn't buy the case. And so you have to kind of shook me. It took me a long time to get over that case. But over the long run, I think the jurors almost always get it right. But when they don't, it breaks your heart.
I know. And sitting here, from what I've heard, the Golden Girls. Resumes and everything. There's some things that stay with me. And one I will always remember, and this was a man who was going to district court, and he he saw in cars. And it was located next to a chemical company. Whatever was spewing out of that building took the finish off of the cars and gave him pancreatic cancer. He had two daughters and a wife, and he was going to court to get a settlement for them because he was attacked. And so he went to court, and the judge, it was held on Halloween, and the judge instructed the jurors to come in Halloween costumes. You can't make this stuff up. You can't even testify to yours. I was going to go to know. But anyway, that was not just one. So anyway, this man was there, and his lawyer couldn't object because it was the judge that was directing it. And I can show you a paper I have in my desk that I've kept all these years. And one of the jurors wrote cast of characters, and she put the name of all the jurors, and beside it, Sally Fields, Kurt Reynolds, and on the bottom it said, "Judge supporter wants to be Robert De Niro." Is that a travesty? If I only impress as a clown, would that make me go into the courthouse? And yet, no one's dressed as a clown, and none brings the traffic posts and so on. And they distributed Halloween candy. It was a party. This man was fighting for settlement because he lost. Now, you talk about injustice, and this is what I want to ask you. When you sentence the same person to act in the game in both oppositions. Women came from New York. I got the paper from the Herald. I'll show you. Her husband was a police officer, special detail during the day on a construction site. 5 children, 2 years old, 13. This woman, 2 years old, into this family without all the they told her to keep quiet in my voice. And he said to her, "Do you know what it is to go without your license for 6 months? That's not empathy, compassion, that's not a joke. But I'm just saying that the sentence does not always fit. And so why I asked you about that disposition was because that's been changed. Before, someone appealed it. Someone appealed it because he got 2 years for drinking and driving. And he got reduced. He appealed it. And that's when they brought in the KL disposition. So it can't be that long. So for me, sitting here, hearing all of the stories that I have from all the other people, I think of that and injustice of that. Just your children, some of them are in the middle of the house, she's supposed to have to this woman. So I don't think justice is available. I do believe, you know, some faith in justice. But I have to say, thank you.